split them down next time, so it's a categorisation if you like, find useful.
Councillor Gibbons?
Yeah, I've already raised this, but it does come up again, and I wanted to fill in one extra thing on the match day parking. It says the council publishing historic internal audit reports into the operation of match day car parks. Now, if it is the case that Salford, as I mentioned, and is a source of investment outside of the original intention to do a completely involved group, I think that would be extremely serious. Either it's not been referred by UCO to audit or audit didn't pick it up. Similarly, if it is the case that a third car park was not in the historic reports, that too seems to me that it'd be a very serious issue. Either non-reference by UCO or not being picked up by internal audit. So I just wanted to to flag that up and supplement the original comments.
Thanks, Councillor. Noted.
Okay, thank you. Other members' comments, questions? Okay, can I move then the recommendation to have the report approved? Okay, item number 7 then, 7, 8 and 9. We've obviously got reports that, items on Garden Festival site on Tunstall Street and British Music Experience. We'll obviously do them each in order. I just want to remind the committee, I appreciate there's going to be a lot of interest in some of these, but let's try and keep it within the remit of the committee. I'm sure that some of you might try and test that in some way. Try and keep your questions and comments within the remits of the committee. So, item 7 at the Garden Festival site, which is on page 93 onwards. Can I ask Chris Ridland to outline the report? I think there is on screen. Yes, there is a presentation.
Chair, if I might just give a brief introduction before I hand over to Chris Ridland. Thank you. So, those who following background, there were two government reports going through in August and September on the significant side of Festival Gardens. August was covering when the major was required, and September was highlighting a new procurement for a developer as well as highlighting specific costs. It was agreed then that we should come to the audit committee to give the purpose of which is to provide assurance on the internal controls and risk management measures employed on the Festival Gardens project, and also acknowledge in this forum progress recently counted and lessons learned. So that's been covered by way of the report, which is on page 93 of the pack, and as the chair highlights, Chris Ridland will highlight an overview presentation. I'm joined by colleagues initially, Chris Ridland and my colleagues, three of us have been working closely.
Thanks, Mark. Thanks, Chair. Dick Hampton, before we do that, I'm going to just bring the project to life.
Will you
just
bring your microphone up?
Yeah, just looking to a presentation, get the project, bring it to life a bit more, and get understanding the scale of the undertaking. So, there's nothing new made that isn't in the report. I'll just run through the background, works involved, current position, achievements to date, and then what you're most interested in is the lessons learned, and then the risk management, project control to move forward to successful completion. So, just on the project background, we as a council acquired the site full of long trees and long delivery back in 2015. And there was a cabinet authority to invest money in site investigation and remediation to create a residential development model. So, at the start of that, we commissioned the consultants contractors to undertake comprehensive site investigation across the whole 90-acre site. That determined that the northern end, 22 acres, which is the subject of the works contract, what we did. We determined the northern end of the site as for development, separate and granular material for reuse, taking the clay material to the grasslands, the separate photo, along with a new landscaped public amenity space, 20 acres in size. And then the waste material unsuitable for use of the domestic landfill will be taken off site for recycling. So that plan cancer has what's been undertaken in terms of the excavation, the delivery of surface water drainage, for the remediation and a follow-on residential developments. And at the top the image is a new substation being delivered to a space cottage power. So we have Vinci Construction, the principal contractor, engineer, we have our own client side, project manager, site supervisor from the technical side, and then critically the NHPC, building land quality endorsement, which you need for future property insurance. We entered the grant funding agreement with Homes England and the Environment Authority to fund that site remediation as well as strategic infrastructure. The requirements of that grant are to deliver remediation infrastructure. And also to deliver follow-on residential plans up to 1,500 units, including 20% of the loans. So where we currently are on site, and obviously the group was back in September, we moved on a little bit from that. We're kind of 90% excavated and reinstated. We approached the winter period, so it's a less efficient time for operation, so it effectively will complete next spring. The surface water drainage 70%, as it says there, and as I mentioned earlier, the substation is now under construction. We've licensed the land to Scottish Power to deliver that, and we hope that to secure all the power supply from that for the follow-on residential developments. So quite a milestone that's been hit last week. In terms of funding, we've drawn down all the Homes England funding. The Combined Authority funding, to be eligible for that, we need to basically complete a land disposal agreement with the development partner. That was the subject of a report back in September, and we're progressing on with that to get to the position where we can draw down that full Combined Authority funding. The most significant matter, I think, that the project's encountered, which was established this summer, is that the material in the former domestic landfill, it being predicted from a range based on the site investigation, around 180,000 cubic metres material, and that's gone up by 10%. Across the site, it averages out between 40 to 50 centimetres deeper. There's kind of reasons for that in terms of mixing of waste with the construction waste underneath. There was limitations in some of the site investigation. The effect of that is that it's added, you know, significant cost to the project. And as a result of the works to process that additional 10% material, we'll have an extension by 6 months. Just the kind of highlight the positives of the project, and you know, it does have issues, challenges, problems. These are effectively what will come out of this, and we'll have a really easy development platform, sustainable brownfield regeneration, which the Environment Agency kind of uses as an exemplar project, sustainable air drainage to mitigate, you know, outflow into the sewer network. Substation will power full developments, and as you can see in the image there, kind of back to the works is this new 28-acre landscape grasslands, which we secured the Environment Authority funding towards. And that kind of will be of the greatest benefit of this scheme, in addition to the new residential community. Through the contract, you know, social values and absolutely most of the contractors, you know, kind of achieve local we've still got budget under the CA, planning tax funding, further infrastructure, file drainage, rubber bands, junction improvements. So, lessons learned, and some of this was obviously set out in the cabinet reports. And on the request from the board, we worked together with all the officers to clearly, you know, draw these out and obviously ensure we carry action and also future projects that councillors probably know the landfill remediation projects, but there are other works and sort of projects that they're definitely worth throwing out and learning from. So I think landfill regeneration remediation, very unique type of project, you know, high risk, probably not something you take on lightly, but it was taken on as a challenge. To regenerate a unique waterfront site for the city, and as I say, for a significant size of the community. On the site investigation I touched on earlier, we spent over 2 years doing this, and significant cost, 125 different locations of investigation, and we did it as comprehensively and as appropriate as coverage as possible. In fact, we went to the limit. Of the environment agency, some of the landfill and operation. The question would be, could we have gone further the site investigation? And the answer, which I just kind of went through here, is no, we were at the limit. With the consultants, with the contractor, and the contractor, everyone was satisfied. It was, you know, a reasonable and robust assessment of the site conditions as far as it can be for a landfill. In terms of the contract that was brought on board, there was five contractors, major principal contractors, the big ones that we went to for civil works. Vinci was the one that had probably the only one with the experience of this type of work and the ability and willing to take on the project. In that respect, it did put them in a position of a fairly good leadership position. They were quite risk averse to the project. And as a result, the contract risks that we were required to take, particularly on the overall type of amounts of material, the type of amounts of waste material, and the programme is obviously manifest. conditions, it being, you know, proficient, rigorous, robust, having weekly, you know, interrogation meetings, early warnings at the earliest possible, possible time, that we've got to ensure this is you know, it's delivered to the programme and the budget available. We can't afford that anymore just to manifest. In terms of the relationship with the funders,
the interim director said this came here from the cabinet.
6 million pounds to look at things like foul drainage, localised heating, and function improvements. One of the things we want to try and reinforce with development is those links both to the water from into the island, but also across Riverside Drive, you know, managing traffic flows, increasing pedestrian availability over that, and very much kind of looking to manage and mitigate the impact and the team developments. Obviously, the wider highway network and the kind of bottleneck, which is trying to lay up all feeds into that. And we did have a discussion with the Highways Capital Project team, interestingly, this week about what this site will require for how we can look at the wider from Sheffield Street to Jericho Lane, have a kind of a wider solution to that particular commuter travel problem. So we are looking into it at this very early stage, and I don't think we can't ignore that. I suppose what we'll have to do is come up with that feasibility and a brief, and you know, segue that back on to the kind of, you know, the senior level for buying into that. So, in terms of getting to that last 10% of the remediation project, that's the team to deliver it. For the moving forward, the developer, that's where we will be in that options analysis, looking at the disciplines we need to help manage that, provide market inputs, legal drafting and development, reading to design work. So, there will be moving forward further inputs. But as I say, we're trying to draw this to a finish and start and kind of
chose another barrister. And therefore, because we've got a suboptimal barrister, we might be getting suboptimal advice, which could cost us a lot more money. So how do we procure legal advice at this level, which if we get it wrong, could cost us a lot?